Welcome to the live session on studying abroad, preparing for your next career milestone. I am Neha Agarwal. I'm an academic communication expert and founder of Wise Up Communications, and I am going to be your facilitator for today. The first thing that we're going to do is understand your goals and why do you want to study abroad. After that, I'm going to share with you all the things that you need to consider, which will help you in choosing universities and programs that you wish to apply to. Next, I'm also going to share insights into the application process and what are the things that you require to complete your applications on time. Then we will come to the main topic that we have for today, which is your SOPs and personal statements. So I'm going to share with you, how do you write an SOP and what is the difference between an SOP and personal statements? Finally, I will share the deliverables of a SOP writing workshop with you for those of you who want to learn how to write your statement of purpose in detail. And hopefully, towards the end, you will have all the information to achieve your next career milestone. So let's begin. Okay, so thanks a lot for participating in the poll. And now let's get to the main topic, which is all things considered. So once you have decided that you want to study abroad, there are some important decisions that you need to make. The first one is master's versus PhD. Even I was at this juncture a few years ago, and for me to decide between master's and PhD was a very difficult decision. And only when I went for master's was when it all became more clear to me. So I'm going to share a few things that you need to consider before making this decision. The first one is career goals. So what do you want to do after you get this degree? Do you see yourself in academia as a researcher or an academician or a professor? Then PhD is definitely for you and you should go for it. But in case you just want like good, better job opportunities, some people have misconception that only PhD can get you better job opportunities. It's not like that. You can go for either master's or PhD. In fact, sometimes what happens is that if you go for a particular job, they actually send you back saying that you're overqualified for the position you're applying. So think about what are your career goals and what do you exactly want to achieve before you choose between master's or PhD. Another thing to consider is finances. So if you go for a master's without scholarship, master's can be very expensive. I think the minimum you should consider is spending 30 lakhs. That's the minimum. It can even be more, including your living expenses, everything. But when it comes to PhD, it usually comes with a stipend, which is almost like $2,000 per month and a waiver of the tuition fees. So when it comes to finances, the amount of money that needs to be invested in a PhD is almost nothing. While in case of master's, you end up spending a lot of money and there's a huge money investment here. But on the other hand, PhD is more time consuming. It involves investment of time, if not money. So PhD roughly ranges from like 4.5 to 5 years. I'm sure a lot of you know that already. While in case of master's, you can actually finish it in 1.5 to 2 years. Along with that, PhD requires commitment, it requires dedication, it requires motivation because it's not an easy degree to complete. So do think about all these factors and especially money versus time before deciding whether you want to go for a master's or PhD. So make that decision accordingly. The next is countries. So once you've decided whether you want to go for a master's or a PhD, and I can see a lot of people are already pretty clear about it, the next thing that you need to do is choose countries. So how do you do that? Now, different countries offer different climates for you to study in. So the first thing that you need to consider is job opportunities. So as per your poll, I saw most of you are actually interested in working abroad, right? So different countries offer different kind of job opportunities. So say, for example, the US. The US is known for its Silicon Valley. So even if you study from a mediocre university, but you study computer science or electronics engineering, the chances of you getting a job is quite high. While on the other hand, if you come from a core engineering field, like mechanical engineering or chemical engineering, even if you're graduating from some of the best universities, sometimes getting a job can be a struggle. While on the other hand, countries like Germany, they have some of the biggest chemical companies and automobile companies in the world. So getting a job in those fields actually becomes very easy. So do think about which industries thrive in different countries and then accordingly make your decision. Another thing you need to consider is scholarships. So when it comes to scholarships, Germany is very liberal. In fact, I have so many friends who did their masters from Germany almost for free. They just had to pay some living expenses, but tuition costs completely taken care of. While on the other hand, if you want to go and study in the US, US universities are literally gold diggers. So getting scholarships are very difficult, and on top of that, the tuition costs are also quite high. On the other hand, for European countries, the tuition costs can be quite low, but the living expenses are high. So do that calculation, see how much amount of money are you going to spend in total, including your tuition costs, living expenses, and then decide what is going to be financially feasible for you, and then make that decision accordingly. Okay. And now, once you have chosen what you want to go for, whether it's master's or PhD, and which countries you want to study in, the next thing that you need to look at is universities. So how do you go about choosing universities? It does require a lot of time and a lot of research. But the first thing that you need to look at are programs. So nowadays, universities have many different kind of programs available, especially if you want to go for a master's, right? They have masters of science, they have masters of engineering, professional masters, and whatnot. So do understand these program requirements carefully and what they have to offer as well. Nowadays, a lot of master's degrees are coming up in the US, which are like just for 9 month duration, so literally three quarters of a year, and they charge almost the same fees. And my suggestion would be to not go for those, because in 9 months you can literally not learn anything. And when you go abroad, it takes almost 3 to 4 months for you to just adjust there. And by the time you adjust there, you will realize that your degree is almost over. Also, 9 months is actually a very short duration for you to be able to, find internships and job for yourself. So my suggestion would be to please read these program about the program information carefully. How long is the program for? What are they offering in the program? Understand those things. So for a master's, a good master's would be where the duration is somewhere between 1.5 to 2 years, because that gives you enough time. Number one, you learn something from that program. Secondly, one of the reasons why we go abroad is for international experience and international exposure, right? So the duration of the program is such that yes, you will have that international interaction with people from other countries in a span of 1.5 to 2 years. And then it also gives you plenty of time to first go and look for an internship, complete your internship, and then look for a job as well. So my suggestion would be please look for masters which are like at least for 1.5 to 2 years duration. Okay. So that was about the programs. Next is research areas. So if you're going for a research-based degree, and I saw that a lot of you are interested in that, like a master's of thesis program or a PhD program, please understand the different research areas that the school has to offer where you're applying and whether it aligns with your research interest and your work experience or not. And my suggestion here would be that do email the professors from beforehand and check with them if they have an availability in their research groups or not. Because especially for PhD programs, how your PhD goes depends a lot on the supervisor that you're working with. So if you have that information from beforehand, it will give you a much clearer picture of what you're getting yourself into. So always a good idea to email professors from beforehand and understand that from them whether they have any openings in their research groups or not. And lastly is categorize. So on the basis of all this information, when once you've chosen the universities, you also need to categorize them. And I'm sure you must have heard about it before. So there are three categories in which you should divide your universities. So say for example, you're applying to like a total of 9 universities. Choose three universities which are ambitious. And what I mean by that is there can be universities which are like your dream universities, and you really want to study there. It can be UC Berkeley or it can be ETH Zurich or anything, but these are ambitious. There are chances that you will not get into it. But if you do get into it, I mean, it's going to be a life changer for you, right? So do choose such three ambitious universities where you would really love to study, but chances might be slim. The next is choose three moderate universities, which are good And your chances to get in are also sort of moderate, you know, it's like a 50-50. You might get in, you might not get in, sort of a thing. And then choose three safe universities, which are decent, but you can definitely get into those universities. And if these are like your only options available in the end from where you've gotten admits, you will not mind studying there. So choose three safe universities as well, and then you should apply to all of them together. Okay, so next we come to the topic, starting the application process. The first thing that you need to do is check all the application requirements carefully. So visit all the websites, see the application requirements. What are the entrance tests do they need? That is your GRE, TOEFL, if anything else is required. Usually not, but just check. CGPA cutoffs that they have. SOP requirements. So most of the universities usually require SOPs, which is statement of purpose. In Germany, it's known as letter of motivation, but it means the same thing. Some universities from the beginning also specify that these are the things you need to include in your SOP. So do check those things from beforehand. And, you know, because then you will be able to incorporate those things in your documents accordingly. Next is personal statements. So while most universities require a statement of purpose, some universities also require a personal statement, especially if you're applying for a scholarship. So check that as well. Then is LORs, which are letter of recommendation. So on an average, universities require like 3 LORs. Some require 2, while very few require 4. So also make that check. Next is research proposals. So if you're going for research-based programs like master's with thesis or PhD, chances are you will also be asked to send a research proposal. So keep that ready as well. And lastly, deadlines. So visit all the websites, see what are the application deadlines, and accordingly prepare yourself. And my suggestion would be to prepare an Excel sheet, list down all the universities you want to apply to, create different columns for all this information, and key everything down. Because sometimes what happens is that all this information can be spread in different pages of the website, and to pick out all this information can take a lot of time. So once you are doing that, make sure you key in everything in an Excel sheet so that you don't have to visit the website again and again for all those information. Okay. So the more more information your Excel has, the less time you will waste on the websites later on. Okay. So make a very comprehensive Excel sheet about all the information regarding the universities. Okay. Next is sending emails to the professors in advance. So a lot of students have this doubt. Should we send emails to professors or should we not send email to professors? Well, depends on the kind of program you're applying to. So if you're applying to a coursework-based program where you just have to complete the courses and you don't have any interaction with the professor on a, like, you know, a one-to-one basis, then you don't have to email the professors. It makes no sense. But if you are applying for a research-based program where you are going to directly work under a supervisor for a research project, either for master's with thesis or for PhD programs or even postdoc programs, then it's always good to email the professors in advance and check with them if they have a research position available. And by emailing, I don't mean that you should spam the professors and, you know, send bulk emails to them. They will never respond. You have to personalize the emails that you're sending to them. And if they really like your profile, they will reply to you. So during my time, I was applying to like 9 to 10 universities. And from each universities, I picked like 4 to 5 professors that I was interested in working with. So I prepared almost 45 to 50 emails, personalized emails for all the professors. Few of them replied, but out of those, 2 of them agreed to take me in. So one was my professor at NTU Singapore, under whom I completed my master's later on. And another was a professor at Georgia Tech. So both accepted. And finally, I decided to go ahead with the NTU professor. So, but what happens is that when professors accept, right, when they agree to take you in, your chances to get an admit from those university increases exponentially. So I got an admit from both of the universities, and it was such a smooth process. Like almost immediately, I got an admit from them because the professors had agreed to take me in. So yeah, emailing is always a good thing, and it can really boost your chances of getting admission. Third is application review and shortlisting. So once you've completed your application and you've submitted it to the universities, the admissions committee carefully scrutinizes your entire application. So your test scores, your transcripts, and all the documents that you have sent, especially the statement of purpose and the personal statement, because they pay a lot of attention to it to see whether you'll be able to fit in the program or not, and whether you'll be able to perform well in that program or not. So that is very important. So once they see that you've, you know, fulfilled like a basic criteria, they also compare you with the pool of candidates. So it might happen that your profile is actually quite decent and you should get an admission in the university. But say, for example, the pool of candidates, basically the other people who applied to that university, their profile is like next level, very, very good. And as compared to that, your profile doesn't match up. So if that is also the case, then you might not get an admit. So it also depends on the pool of candidates who are applying and what is the quality, and not just on your application. But obviously what you can do from your end is like send the best possible application and then just, you know, hope for the best. So this is how the entire application process usually works. Now coming to SOP and personal statements. So as I have been stressing again and again, a statement of purpose and a personal statement are very important documents which are carefully scrutinized by the admissions committee. So when I was at this juncture 5 years ago, I was also applying for my master's, and I knew I had like a good, decent profile. I felt like that, but I was not at all sure about my communication skills. And I was like, if I write the SOP by myself, I'm never going to get into any of my dream universities. So what I did was I found an SOP writer who wrote SOP for the students. And even though he was charging a very high price, I was like, okay, let's just do this. All right. So I did go ahead with that person. And when I got my SOP back, it looked very fake. You know, it looked very impersonal. I mean, my qualifications and everything were there, but that can apply to anybody. It did not showcase my talent, my personality, or my story in any way. So in the end, I decided not to use that SOP, and later on I wrote the SOP myself, and that got me an admission into some of the best universities in the Singapore and the US. So that is why I'm actually doing a workshop in SOP writing, so that you can learn how to write an SOP and then write it yourself, because you know yourself best, the best, right? You know what is your story, and nobody else can do this for you. So anyways, not digressing from the topic, let's try and learn how to write an SOP. Okay, so there are 4 steps that you need to follow. The first one is brainstorming ideas. So when I decided to write the SOP myself, I just sat down to write one. Don't do that. That's a mistake I made. The first thing that you should do is just brainstorm ideas. Go into flashback mode and think about all your life experiences, and then answer these questions. The first one is, why do I want this degree? So a lot of you will think, hey, I want a degree because better job opportunities, or I want a degree because of international exposure. Well, if you think about it, these are like side benefits of getting that degree. But what is the real reason why you want to pursue this degree and not anything else? Why do you want to specialize in this area? Or why are you so passionate about this field? Think about these things and answer them as honestly as possible. The next one is, how are my qualifications and experiences going to make me a good fit in the program? So the admissions committee does look at these things in order to see your fit in the program and whether you'll be able to tackle the challenges of the graduate program or not. So you have to think about what are your experiences, your achievements, your qualifications, which will show that, yes, you have handled such challenging situations multiple times in your career. And with that experience, any challenge that you face in the graduate program, you will be able to tackle it and succeed in it. Third one, what courses or programs features excite me? So it's important that you visit the college's website and see what are the kind of courses and programs that they are offering, because this gives an idea to the admissions committee that, yes, you have done your research and you know what are the programs offering and what you're getting yourself into. And lastly, what do I want to do after I get this degree? So think about, what are your career goals? What are your career aspirations? And what do you want to do after this degree? And how will this degree help you achieve those things? So this also gives an idea to the admissions committee that you know what you want in life and how this degree can help you in future. Okay. So think about these things and jot them down somewhere. Okay. The next is, develop an outline. So keep your brainstorming ideas aside, and now develop an outline for your SOP. So you should divide it into three sections. First one is the introduction, second is the body, and the third is the conclusion, okay? So in the introduction section, how you should write it is probably have like an attention-grabbing hook. So say, for example, what was your motivation to study in that program? Or when was the first time that you decided that you actually want to study and, you know, pursue a higher degree in this field? So my suggestion would be to write this in the form of a story. And what I mean by story is that it should not be super long and it should be strictly professional. So the language should be professional. Just because you're sharing a story or an experience from your life, that doesn't mean you can just write it anyway or in any spoken English. No, it has to be still strictly professional. But a story acts as an attention-grabbing hook and really gives a good start to your SOP. The next is the body. So here, you need to include all your sum total of all your qualifications, accomplishments, experience, everything. So you can start with your academic background. What are some courses that you've taken in college that have really built your interest in that field? What are some of the technical projects that you worked on? If you have research experience, how was your research experience like? You can also share your internship experience, work experience. So in terms of work experience, you can share which kind of team were you working in the company? What were some of your responsibilities? What did you finally learn out of it? So instead of just listing down the experiences, what is important is that you share some of the challenges that you faced while doing those things. And finally, what did you learn out of it? And what was the end result? And what did you gain? That is important. Okay. And also remember, this is not a rehash of your resume. You don't have to include everything that your resume contains. Not needed. See, what the admissions committee is looking for is they're trying to judge whether you are a good fit for the program or not. So include information that is relevant for them and that makes them understand that, yes, you can fulfill all the requirements of the program and excel at it. Is this meeting being recorded? Yes, the meeting is being recorded and I will share the recording with you later on. Yeah. The last one is conclusion. So here you need to show a synergy between you and the university. So how it's a win-win for you and the university. So you have to talk about that. See, these are the things I'm going to gain from the university and benefit from the university. But at the same time, as a student, this is what I'm going to offer to the program, or this is what I'm going to offer to the university. And these are the skills that I'm bringing to the table. So in this way, you should conclude your SOP and end it in a positive note and show how you are ready to accept the challenges that come with the program. Okay, so this is how the outline looks like. So now you have your brainstorming ideas and now you have an outline with you. Okay, the third thing that you need to do is now start writing. So write the first draft, take stuff from your brainstorming ideas, put them in the IBC structure and start writing. Okay. Try and make a nice story out of it, which is a window into your professional side, okay? And here, don't worry about the grammar, don't worry about language, word limit, just keep writing so that whatever information you want in your SOP, everything is there in that document, okay? And once you're done with your first draft, leave it aside. Leave it aside for 2-3 days and don't even look at it. Then come back and start editing your SOP. So here you have to pay attention to what are some of the requirements of the universities. Make sure you include those things. Then start editing your SOP and make sure you include sophisticated vocabulary, professional language, because the admissions committee also looks at that, because the kind of academic communication that you have shows them how well you will be able to perform in the program. Okay. Then obviously proofread for spelling, grammar, punctuation, ensure there is a smooth flow in your SOP and all the paragraphs, you know, flow very smoothly one after the other. So do all these changes. Check for word limit. Usually universities specify sometimes word limit, so it's somewhere between 500 to 1000 words. So keep editing your SOP, remove extra stuff that is not super important. So keep going through this process again and again, till you have an SOP that you feel is the best version of what you could have prepared, okay? And once you're ready with that, choose 3 people whom you trust and who have a good command over English and ask them to review your SOP and provide feedback to you. And once they do that, look at their feedback, see which are some of the important changes that should be made to your SOP and make those things. And once you do all those things and once you make all the changes necessary, you will have an SOP that is ready for submission. So guys, this entire process can take up to 1 month if you really want a good SOP. So my suggestion would be to not wait till September or October and start writing your SOP. A good time would be to probably start in another 1-2 months so that you have sufficient time and these documents are ready well in advance, even before you start applying. Okay. So now coming to what is the difference between statement of purpose and personal statements. Most universities require a statement of purpose. Some universities also require personal statements. So what is the difference? Well, let's see. The first one is the purpose. So for SOP, as the name suggests, the purpose is to actually show your purpose, your intent and your motivation to pursue graduate study. So in an SOP, you need to showcase yourself as the right fit for the program based on your credentials and qualifications. While what do we write in a personal statement? A personal statement, the main purpose of a personal statement is to showcase who you are. Something that they will not understand by reading your transcript or reading your resume. So it showcases your personality and how you blend with the social and the cultural environment of the university. And by social and cultural, we don't mean what is your race or what is your ethnicity. No, it means the kind of values and the kind of mindset and the kind of, you know, yeah, all these experiences, life experiences that you are bringing and how well you blend with that sort of a student community. So that is what they are trying to see. The next thing is focus. So the focus of an SOP is forward looking. You are constantly talking about how this degree is going to help you in the future, what you plan to do ahead, what are your career goals and how this degree will help you achieve those. While in a personal statement, the focus is backward looking. Here you reflect on your past experiences and you talk about how those experiences have made you the person that you are today. So that is the focus of a personal statement. So if you actually look, a statement of purpose together with the personal statement actually give a sum total of your entire professional and personal experience and both in the past and future. Okay, so they work very well together actually. The third is content. So how are you supposed to arrange the content then in your SOP and in your personal statement? So for an SOP, it has a sharp focus. The content has a sharp focus. Whatever information you're writing in your SOP, you're constantly writing to convince the admissions committee that yes, I am fit for the program and I can do well in the program. So constantly the agenda is that. But in case of a personal statement, what is the difference? It is more general. Here you think about your life experiences, something, you know, which has been a very significant experience for you and which has shaped your personality and helped you in becoming the person that you are. And how that shows that your, how that shows your uniqueness and the fact that you are a worthy candidate for that program. So it's more general, but then again, towards the end, it does bring you back to show that yes, you are, your personality is very unique and that is why you are worthy to be joining that program. Okay. And lastly is the key features. So what is the information that you are going to include? So the key features for statement of purpose is your college education, work or internship experience, technical project, research publication, reasons for backlogs. So say, for example, you've not scored well in one of the semesters. You also need to explain that in your SOP. Achievements, why you want to study in that university and program, your future career goals and all that. Something I've already shared with you earlier on, right? And here what comes in personal statement, cultural or financial background. So what are some of the challenges that you have faced, either being a part of your culture that you come from or your financial condition? If there were some challenges, you can share that. Then traditional attitude towards studies. So say, for example, in your family, what has been the attitude towards studies? Are all the people very well read and, you know, learned people in your family? Or are you probably the first generation person to ever go to college or to ever go and study abroad? Right? You can share that. Why you value higher education and international exposure? Why is it so important for you to study abroad? Why can't you do this degree in India? So what is the real motivation? You should share that as well. How unrelated experiences like volunteering have taught perseverance, love, hope for humanity. So what are the different life experiences that you have had that has made you the person that you are, somebody who is willing to give back to the society and building a community? That is the kind of people that they're looking for today in their programs, not somebody who is very self-centered. But how the person after taking that degree is also going to do something and give back to the society and give back to the community. So these are some of the things you should include in your personal statement. Okay, so is the difference very clear, guys? At least you have a basic understanding now what goes in each of the documents. Now coming to examples. So now I'm going to share an exercise with you guys. I'm going to share two paragraphs with you. Okay, these two paragraphs are about the same experience, but one paragraph is a part of SOP and one paragraph is a part of personal statement. So you have to read those paragraphs and tell me which paragraph belongs to an SOP, which paragraph belongs to a personal statement, because the way you write that same experience in an SOP and in a personal statement will differ. Okay, so the example I'm sharing is from Masters in Public Health. The person got into UC Berkeley and these are the two paragraphs. So take some time, read this, and then we're going to have a short discussion on this. Okay, yes, thank you. Right. So guys, the first one is from an SOP. So even though both these experiences are about helping the community, the first one is very professional. You know, it strictly focuses on, okay, what the person did to help the community in a very structured manner, that we had divided them, mapped them into zones, and these are the things that we did. It doesn't attach any personal feelings or personal emotions to it. It just talks slightly professionally in how the entire thing was executed, right? But what about the second paragraph? In the second paragraph, you're talking about your personal feelings, your personal opinion regarding that. So it is something very personal and focuses on your opinion and beliefs rather than talking more about what you actually did and how did you actually help those disadvantaged communities. So you see, a same experience can be written in such different ways in a personal statement and in an SOP. So now are you clear what is like the tone that you need to adopt when writing an SOP and when writing a personal statement? And you see, for both of them, the language is still strictly professional. Yeah, it's not very casual language. It is still strictly professional, but personal statement, as the name suggests, slightly more personal, slightly attaches more opinions and personal beliefs to it, while the SOP, strictly professional, talks about professionally what were some of the challenges, actions taken, finally what was the result out of it, and all those things. Yeah. Okay, so guys, that is all that I actually wanted to share today from this session. And now coming to the deliverables of the workshop. So starting from next week onwards, for those of you who want to go for internships abroad or are planning to study abroad, conducting a workshop on writing your statement of purpose. It's going to consist of 5 sessions and 1.5 hours each. And it's going to be only on weekends, and it starts from next week onwards. Okay. And these are the deliverables of the workshop. The first one is understand the criteria used by the universities to shortlist candidates. So today I shared a very brief overview of what the universities look for. We're actually going to deep dive into it and understand what are the small things that universities want in your statement of purpose that will help you stand out from other applicants. Next is conducting research. So I told you earlier, right, different universities have different requirements, and you can't send the same SOP to all the 10 universities. No, you have to constantly tailor your SOP for different universities as well. So how can you use a fixed template and then keep tailoring your SOP? We're going to talk about that also. Then brainstorming. So today I just shared like a brief with you as to how you're supposed to brainstorm. We're going to deep dive into it and share like all the small parts that need to go in your SOP and what are the things that you need to include that will set your application apart from the others. And then I'm going to help you write your SOPs and share so many examples with you, with people from the top universities like Georgia Tech, Columbia University, UC Berkeley, and so that you have an idea that what kind of SOP you need to write that will get you admission into those universities. Okay, next is building your confidence. So I am going to share a lot of exercises with you and make you write all this information so that you get confidence that you can write the SOP yourself and you don't need anybody's help. And lastly, learn how to write personal statements along with SOPs. So we are also going to cover how should you write your personal statements along with the SOPs. Okay. Can research scholars join your session? Absolutely. I think it's going to be very useful for you guys as well. So there are 2 plans available, guys. First is the standard plan, which will include 5 live and interactive sessions. They are much smaller groups, so we actually speak over the microphone and, you know, not just via chat. complete course material will be provided, access to session recordings. In case you miss few of the sessions, we'll give you access to the session recordings so that you can watch them. And lastly, studying abroad support groups. So we will have groups of students who are planning to go abroad and, you know, applying to different universities so that you can talk to each other and clear all those doubts. So this is the pricing that's given on the screen. And another one is a premium plan. So here, everything in standard is going to be there. But along with that, once you've written your SOP, if you want personal feedback from me on your SOP, I will provide you with two rounds of feedback. And say, for example, if you want to attend the workshop now, but you want to write your SOP 3 months, 4 months later, you have actually 1 year validity to avail that feedback from me. And the pricing is also there on the screen. Okay. So in order to join this workshop, or if you want to see more details about it, or if you have some common doubts, we've also prepared like a facts page and you can just check those things out. So when I had actually paid that SOP writer 5 years ago, that person had actually charged me 5,000 rupees for writing my SOP. So I think the prices have actually even gone up since then. So I think that way these prices are pretty decent and you're getting almost everything that you need from this workshop. Okay. Yes. Now we're almost at the end. So after that, I will clear all your doubts. So guys, wish you all the very best. And I hope the information that I've shared with you will give you a much more clearer picture of what lies ahead of you and how you're supposed to prepare for your applications abroad. And in case you want to know more information, I keep posting these study abroad videos on our YouTube channel. So you can actually visit our YouTube channel and check out more information. Thank you so much, guys. Thanks a lot. That is all for today. If you have any more questions, do reach out to me on Instagram and then I will answer your queries personally. Okay. So thanks a lot.